3 hours. No, not 3 hours. We'll go through our session. Won't really continue off of what Mike did, kind of going in my own direction. I was telling Paul and Dean this morning that was really waiting to be inspired of the Lord. Mike asked me a couple weeks ago to teach on Sunday and said, all right. So I started thinking and praying about it and didn't really get inspired at all until yesterday morning. So sometimes that's the way God works. Sometimes the way he wants it. So what I'm going to do is take you through some of what I've been reading in the morning. So I'm in Genesis chapter 26. If you want to flip there in your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, there should be somebody with a Bible extra to kind of help you out and get you one. All right, let me pray. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me, please? Father God, we would just see you this morning. Jesus, would you just help me to get out of the way, and would you just usher in, Lord God? Would you teach us, Lord God, embolden us to be more about you, Lord God, in our weeks and our days, Lord God? Teach us, inspire us, Lord God. Teach us about this great love, Lord God, that you have given us and have passed on to us. Be with us now, in Jesus' name, amen. Cool. So Genesis is where I'm reading in my mornings. I recently finished my Bible just a couple days ago, so every time I finish my Bible in Revelation, I'm always right back into Genesis, and I usually pick a new Bible, but this time I want to go back to my old study Bible, which I haven't read out of really in several years. I've been in some other Bibles, so it's been really fun to just go back to my old notes and be able to see them there. It's really refreshing just to kind of see the different perspective that I had before, but Genesis, I want to give you a little bit of background, right? So we all know the basics of Genesis and the four principal characters that are found there, right? So Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, right? That's kind of the four lineage people that we know, starting from Genesis about 12 and goes all the way to 50. In chapter 26, what has actually happened is that Abraham, right, the father of many nations, has just died, actually. And so he's left his son. Isaac and Ishmael, his half-brother, have just buried him. So what now, right? This great spiritual inspiration has just happened with Abraham, his father, great leader, and now he's gone. So what do we do? There's also going to be a famine in the land. Abraham lived through something that was very similar to what Isaac is about to go through. So it's always interesting whenever the Bible kind of repeats itself and shows patterns, it's always kind of good to glean new things off of them because it does it for a reason, right? If it's something that's repeated, it does it for a reason. I chose this chapter because when I was reading yesterday morning, I thought, wow, like I could probably tell you a lot about Abraham and Jacob and Joseph. Right? We all know a lot about Abraham, how he was the father of many nations, how he was the stalwart of faith, how he believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, how he always continually left everything that he had to trust in God and to live in tents in a land that there was a bunch of other people already. Right? What a strange thing that is that I can't really grasp. Right? If somebody just showed up on your lawn one day and was like, hey, God told me to live here, right? That would be a little strange, right? That's what Abraham did, right? God called him to live in the land that was already occupied. Great faith. Jacob. When we think of Jacob, the first thing I think of is him wrestling with God, right? You think of his dream of the stairway to heaven coming back and forth, how he stole his brother's birthright and his blessing, and that he's the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. Joseph. Joseph is probably my favorite, right? How he goes from rags to riches. He's the great story of his brothers hating him, selling him into slavery, and his rise because of God into the second in command in Egypt. He is an absolute hero in terms of his willingness to follow God, right? When temptation came, runs the other way. High intellect, high character, guy that's undeniable. What do we know about Isaac? It's one of those where he, in Genesis, in a lot of ways, when I look at him, he's kind of a background figure, right? So he's in a lot of chapters, and a lot of stories have Isaac in them, but in a lot of them, he's kind of the secondary figure, right? So one of the main things that I think of with Isaac is he's a secondary figure when Abraham is getting ready to do something with him, right? He's the sacrifice, but he's really the secondary person in that story. We think of the great story of Isaac going to find his wife in the other land, right? And he finds Rebekah and brings her home. But it wasn't him that was sent out, right? It was Abraham's slave that went out to get the wife and bring back. So interesting that Isaac, who's mentioned all over the Bible, it's kind of hard to think of what is his real story and who is he and what is he about? His name means he laughs. Why is that? Why is it that he laughs? It's because he was the son of Abraham in his extreme old age, right? The fact that he was going to have a son when he was 100 years old. His wife is Rebekah. He was married at 40 years old, and she is a picture of strength. She's a picture of being strong-willed, beautiful. She's an awesome character. His first kids come at about when he's 60, and then he lives about 180 years. Okay, so that's kind of the stats of who Isaac is. But what is he really? So I thought Genesis 26 kind of laid out some of his story. So I thought I'd take you with me. So read with me. My general play is to read through the chapter so we get the entire context, and then I'll kind of pick it apart. All right, so read with me through chapter 26, please. Now there was a great famine in the land. Besides the earlier famine of Abraham's time, and Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you and will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands, and I will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give them all these lands. And though your offspring, through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed, because Abraham obeyed and kept my requirements, my commands, my decrees, and my laws." So Isaac stayed in Gerar. When the men of that place asked him about his wife, he said, "She's my sister," because he was afraid to say, "She's my wife," he thought. "The men of this place might kill me on account of Rebekah, because she's beautiful." When Isaac had been there a long time, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked down from a window and saw Isaac caressing his wife Rebekah. So Abimelech summoned Isaac and said, "She's really your wife. Why did you say she's my sister?" Isaac answered him, "Because I thought I might lose my life on account of her." Then Abimelech said, "What is this you have done to us? One of the men might have slept with your wife, and you would have brought guilt upon us." So Abimelech gave orders to all the people, "Anyone who molests this man or his wife shall surely be put to death." Isaac planted crops in the land, and the same year reaped a hundredfold because the Lord blessed him. The man became rich, and his wealth continued to grow until he became very wealthy. He had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines envied him. So all the wells that his father's servants had dug in the time of his father Abraham, the Philistines stopped up, filling them with earth. Then Abimelech said to Isaac, "Move away from us. You've become too powerful for us." So Isaac moved away from there and encamped in the valley of Gerar and settled there. Isaac reopened the wells that had been dug in the time of his father Abraham, and the Philistines had stopped up after Abraham died, and he gave them the same names his father had given them. Isaac's servants dug in the valley and discovered a well of fresh water there. But the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen and said, "The water is ours." So he named the well Esek, because they disputed with him. Then they dug another well, but they quarreled over that one also, so he named it Sitna. He moved on from there and dug another well, and no one quarreled with it. He named it Rehoboth, saying, "Now the Lord has given us room, and we will flourish in the land." From there he went up to Beersheba. The night the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bless you and will increase the number of your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham." Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord, and there he pitched his tent, and there his servants dug a well. Meanwhile, Abimelech had come to him from Gerar with Ahuzath, his personal advisor, and Phicol, the commander of his forces. Isaac asked them, "Why have you come to me, since you were hostile to me and sent me away?" They answered, We saw clearly that the Lord was with you. So we said, there ought to be a sworn agreement between us and you. Let us make a treaty with you that you will do us no harm, just as we did not molest you, but always treated you well and sent you away in peace. And now you are blessed by the Lord. Isaac then made a feast for them, and they ate and drank. Early the next morning, the men swore an oath to each other. Then Isaac sent them on their way and left them in peace. That day, Isaac's servants came and told him about the well they had dug. They said, we found water. He called it Sheba. And to this day, the name of the town has been called Beersheba. When Esau was 40 years old, he married Judith, daughter of Beeri the Hittite, and also Basemath, daughter of Elon the Hittite. They were the source of grief to Isaac and Rebekah. So, kind of a long one, and we'll hit parts of it, but exciting in a lot of ways because there's a lot going on in there. A lot that it's easy for me when I'm reading my chapters in the morning to just kind of gloss over and not really focus on the depth and the wealth that is available for us. Verse 1, now there was a famine in the land. Right? That's a super easy one for me to gloss over because I say, oh, okay, so they were hungry, right? But it's not something that I easily relate to, right? So last night, I'm hungry and there's no real leftovers, no real meal made, no plan for it. So I'm scavenging through the refrigerator and can't really find anything of substance that I'm super excited about. So I make a sandwich, right? And I'm a little like, oh, okay, I'll make a sandwich and I'll get through it. But there's something there for me, right? I'm a little hungry, but I'm not in the place where they are, famine. I don't think that there's many of us here that can really relate to famine, right? So that's the first part, right? Kind of putting yourself in the context of what's happening. Now there's a famine. There's something really hard going on. Something probably, right, if you think about the story right before this of Jacob and Esau, something probably affected there too, right? Esau made some poor decisions because he was hungry, right? Judgment is getting clouded because they are hungry, right? There is a severe famine in the land. You can't just go to your refrigerator and get something, okay? So famine, I don't know what I would do, right? I'm a little bit heavier now than I was 15 years ago out of college. But anytime I want something, I've got it, basically. So trying to put yourself in the mind of where it is, it's a famine. Judgments are getting clouded. Isaac here, besides the earlier famine of Abraham's time, and Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines in Gerar. Yes, the same Philistines that they struggled with year after year after year, right? Goliath of the Philistines, the same Philistines that bothered Joshua in all the conquests, the same Philistines that bothered King David in all of his conquests. These are the same Philistines. And Gerar, if you have a picture in your mind of kind of the nation of Israel and how it's connected to everything, the land of Canaan where Abraham was told to go, the land of blessing, is kind of up here. And below it, to the south, is the land of Gerar. Keep going, you've got the Negev and then Egypt. Okay? So right now, he is not in this land of blessing where he's supposed to be. In fact, he's going the opposite way. Why is he going the opposite way? Because there's a famine, right? Real strife, real hunger. God has asked him to be in this land, but he's leaving. He's going the other way. Important point. So in verse 2, we pick it up again. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, don't go down to Egypt, right? Kind of showing his intentions. He was going down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you and will bless you. For to you and your descendants, I will give all these lands and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and will give them all these lands. And through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed. So his intentions were to leave. God is warning him not to go to Egypt, which in our case, in my life, in your life, could be something different, right? So we always kind of think of, okay, how does this relate to me? God is asking him to stay in a place where he definitely knows that there's going to be strife, right? He knows what's coming in Isaac's life, but he asks him to stay there anyways. There's a reason for that. Sometimes it would be easy just to move on. In kind of worldly terms, we think maybe suffering, whatever point I'm suffering at in my life, maybe that means it's time to move on to something that's easier, to something that's worldly, to something that I can be okay with my friends over here. But maybe that's not what God has for us. Suffering is one of those things that has always been difficult for me to grasp. I don't know about you. Why does it say over and over in the Bible that rejoice in your sufferings? That's a really difficult concept to grasp, especially for the non-believer, right? So one of my favorite passages that helped me through some of the stuff that happened in the last 5-6 years was Romans chapter 5, when it's talking about perseverance. It starts with this idea of hope and the hope that we have in Jesus, right? Here, Isaac has this hope, this promise from God about what he is going to be. We have a hope if you're a believer in Jesus. And if you have that hope, the Bible says that part of that is that we're going to rejoice in our sufferings, because we will have sufferings. Everybody is going to have tough stuff that happens. You might have seasons where you go up and down, but you will have suffering. But part of that suffering is that God provides strength for you in perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. God bookends it, right? Starts with hope, the hope that we have in Jesus. It doesn't start in ourselves. It starts with the promise, much like the promise that was given to Isaac. And it ends in hope, right? It's on both sides. If it wasn't on both sides, we'd be in trouble, right? If it starts with me, I'm in trouble. And if it ends with me, I'm in trouble, right? It's got to start and end with Jesus. So God is telling us to stay sometimes. Stay in the land of promise because you're awesome. No, not because you're awesome, because you're the opposite, right? As much as I like some of you guys, it's because God will be with you. I think that's one of the things that I have tried to carry the most with me in my daily walk, the idea of God being with me. I was told early on in my faith, I accepted Jesus at 17, that try to imagine like Jesus always being by your side. And at first that was like a really freaky thought, right? Like, okay, you're a little weird, right? But Jesus being with me today is something that I can't live without. I can't live without him on a moment-by-moment basis. Whether everything is going great or I'm dealing with the hardest events of my life. He says, stay, because I will be with you. Joshua and the nation of Israel, when they were given the promise to take over the land of promise, hey, so we're getting into the book of Joshua. If you remember the story, him and Caleb go out with a bunch of other guys, sneak out the land, and they're like, uh-oh, like, this is awesome land, it's really good, milk and honey, right? But there's people in the land already, much like Abraham, there's already people here, right? And not only were they people, but they were giants, they were good warriors, it put the fear of God basically in them, and they kind of ran the other way. Two of them kind of held their ground, and were like, we can do it. God is with us. It's interesting that when God said, yes, you can do it, the nation of Israel was like, no, we can't. And then God kind of met them where they're at and said, okay, no, you're not going to do it. And then what did they say? Yes, let's do it, right? They chose the opposite. He says, yes, go into the land. And they're like, no, we can't do it. All right, no, you can't. You're not going to do it now. It's not happening anymore. Yes, let's do it. Let's force it, right? And Moses warns them, don't do it. God's not with you anymore. The important piece was God was with them. We often cloud these promises of God with worry, concern, panic over our time, money, possessions, family, struggle, injury, sickness, loss, whatever you call it, right? The cloudiness in this time in Isaac's story was the famine. But all of us have moments of cloudiness that are making our decisions difficult. God will be with you, and he'll give you the right path. Moving back into the story of Genesis. So in 3, stay in this land for a while, and I'll be with you, and will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands, and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and will give them all these lands. And through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed, because Abraham obeyed me and kept my requirements, my commandments, my decrees, and my laws. So Isaac stayed in Gerar. So again, it's interesting that he asks him to stay in the land, even though he knows that there's going to be hardship. God's promise to you is, my God will meet all your needs. God asks him to stay because he can see the blessing in the end. Can we? That's the hard part, right? We've got the obstacle in front of us. Can we accept God's promise to us? Because we already know the end. Right? What's the end story of this world? Do we win or not? Does God win? He wins, right? If you check out Revelation, the last chapter, he wins and we're with him. It's awesome. Don't be anxious. It's already done. We just have to go through it. He sees the blessing for us even when we can't. It's amazing. That's where the trust part comes in. I've had over the past couple years a lot of decisions to make as far as work and family. If you don't know, I've been a high school teacher in a school in South Sacramento for 15 years now, which is kind of weird to say, but it's been 15 years. And I've really felt called in the time that I've been there to be there. It's always been a tough situation for a variety of reasons, but I've always felt like it was for me, even though it can be a struggle. A few years ago, I also moved on and am now coaching at Jessup up in Rockland, a university. And so trying to split my time between the South Sac stuff and then the Rockland stuff and then balance my 3 kids and my wife and still have time for them has been a real struggle. Mostly because I always try to prioritize my stuff, right? I can always have God with me wherever I go, but I can't always have my wife with me wherever I go, right? How do I live this life and make sure that I'm with her? How do I live this life, do everything I can for God, and make sure I'm with my 3 kids? It's my daughter's birthday today, by the way. Anna, happy birthday. She's 10. So how do we know when it's time to move on? I've been thinking a lot recently and praying a lot recently the last few years. This schedule's not really working for me. How do I make it work? How do I know, God, when it's time to move on? I feel like you've called me to be in this place, at this job. I definitely know you've got this family for me. How do I make it all work? Because it's not working right now. I come home and I'm overloaded. There's too much to do. How do we know when to move on? Is it when it's hard? No, that's probably not a good gauge. It's been one of the hardest years for me mentally because I come home and I am drained. I'm spent. And I'm constantly praying in mornings, God, please help me not to be like the teacher that is at the last few years of service and is just there. Right? That would be the ultimate thing for me that I would despise. And I can see it in myself a little bit already. Not because I'm necessarily doing that, but my attitude is starting to go there because I feel spent. Like I've given everything I have. I don't want to be so I teach PE, right? So I'm always moving. So just standing here in one spot for the last 10-15 minutes is brutal, by the way, right? I should have like a mic and be able to go all over and here's a ball. But no, can't do that. No balls. Sorry. So I'm a PE teacher. So the burnout PE teachers are the ones like, all right, here you go. Here's a basketball. I'm going to go sit over here and do some grades or whatever, right? That's never been my style. I've always wanted to be engaged with the guys, with the girls, making sure they know that I'm about more than that. I don't want to be burned out. At home, the battle is, I'm so burnt out from work that I don't have any energy for my kids, right? How do we get to that place where we've got enough? It's not in me. It's with God. How do we know when to move on? Well, my belief is you go when God tells you to go. And you go when he opens the doors for the next path. When you've sought answers through three things: prayer, prayer, and prayer. It's prayer over and over again, because prayer is your communication. It's your pipeline to God of what's going on. One of my favorite stories in the book of Joshua, right, is they're about to go on the land, and Joshua runs into this guy, right, this amazing figure, and he's like, are you for us or against us, sir? And what does the guy say? What does Jesus say, right? Neither. Are you on my side or not? Standing there with the sword ready to go, right? Are we with God ready to go? I believe that when it's my time to move, he'll open that door. He'll be ready. He will answer. So here in verse 6 says that Isaac stayed in Gerar. Not quite the promised land, not quite all the way down to Egypt, but kind of in between, right? He chooses to stay on this borderline between Egypt, kind of the worldly thing, and the promised land in Canaan. Where do we hang out? Are we living in the fullness and the greatness of everything that God has promised us? Are we living in full outright sin in the world? Or are we somewhere in between? Are we lukewarm? Know what God says about lukewarm people, right? Spit them out. He doesn't want that. He doesn't want that of us. So he chooses to stay. It's interesting because Abraham made a really similar choice. He chose to stay. He chose to go to Egypt, okay, full out all the way there, and ended up making a lot of the same decisions that Isaac made, lying and leaving. Okay? And it's interesting the timing of how all this happens, because a lot of times in the Bible, it doesn't pull any punches, right? It's fully honest. Something great happens, God's in your life, and then 2 seconds later, like I'm going the other direction, right? So watch out. Beware. Abraham's choice was to leave and to go to Egypt. A bunch of other stories that we can think of where similar things happen, right? So the book of Ruth, in the very beginning, Naomi and Elimelech, they leave the land of promise. Why do they leave the land of promise? Anybody know? Why do they leave? Famine, right? Really similar story. So they leave and they go to Moab, which is called the wash basin by God. Really not a good place to live, right? Blessing, wash basin. Blessing, wash basin. Wash basin, right? Not a good place to be. And disaster strikes when they're there. The family dies off. The only one left is Naomi. And Ruth goes with Naomi back to the land of promise. And there the blessings begin, because they're back in the blessings of promise. Amazing. Elijah goes through a severe famine, right? He's so humbled that he goes out and he is fed by a poor widow and by birds, right? You imagine that? How humbling is that for this great prophet of God to be having to go out of the land in a severe famine and be fed by birds and a poor widow? Jesus in Matthew 4, after 40 days of fasting, right? I can maybe go one fasting, 40 days of fasting, That's when Satan goes after him, right? Tempting him in the desert, right? Turn these stones into bread. Man doesn't live on bread alone, but by the word of God. My choices. How I often feel like I'm kind of balancing, right? Here's the land of blessing. Here's the land of the world. Sometimes I find myself in between. How close can I get to playing with this without getting burned? Do I stand for the Lord in a place that he would have me, or am I lukewarm? And what does it look like to be all the way over here in the land of blessing? When I think about leaving some of the jobs that I have and moving on to other stuff, and maybe perhaps there will definitely be a time that God wants me to move on. Maybe there's a time when God wants you to move on from the struggle and strife that you're in. I always come back to, what are you doing with your time now? Not just the showing up and the work, but are you sharing Jesus with the people that you're with on a daily basis, right? Not just, are you doing the work to the best of your ability? Are you sharing Jesus? Maybe I do only have a few months left at my job, but when I leave, have I shared Jesus? Verse 7, when the men of that place asked him about his wife, parallel to this, to the story of Abraham, he said, she's my sister, because he was afraid to say, she's my wife. He thought the men of this place might kill me on account of Rebecca, because she's beautiful. He's lying because he's afraid. He's got fear. We all have fear. Several things strike me about this, because one of my greatest fears is that my children will make some of the same mistakes that I do, that I see in myself. I worry often that, especially, I don't know what it is, but I feel like my Anna is, she's super strong in character. I feel like she's going to be fine. Maybe things will kind of turn someday for her, but the one I always worry about is Jaden, right? And maybe it's because he's my only son, and maybe there's a different connection there, but he's the one I always worry about. I would hate, and I can't imagine if he struggles with the same things that I struggle with. Can we see him making the same choices out of fear? One of my struggles that God has been forever breaking me of since I first got saved was pride, right? And part of that pride was not being able to say, I'm sorry. And I see it in my son all the time, right? He's infuriating his sister, but throwing a ball against her or something, and there's the whining, there's the crying, like, ah, Jaden, what'd you do, right? Nothing. Would you just say you're sorry and mean it, right? It's so hard for him to say he's sorry and mean it. Or maybe he'll be like, ah, I'm sorry, right? And he'll wander off. Totally here too. I think it's hard to say because it's admitting that you're wrong and that you're not perfect. And I feel like I'm in a place where I'm cool with that with God. I can be totally honest and upfront, but it's hard sometimes to tell my son I'm sorry. Can I model that for him? Can Dad be wrong? That's an amazing struggle that I don't think I ever thought that I would have. To be able to tell my son, Jaden, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have got mad at you. But that's what he needs. This part is interesting to me again because he's lying here, right? And the previous verses again where God appeared in his life. None of us have ever been there, right? Where God has appeared in your life and told you something of great blessing, word for word, and we just lived in it. Here, God has done that for him. He's provided him a great blessing, the same one that he gave to his dad. Next minute, he's lying. amazing how simplistic we can be. It's kind of a pattern that's interesting. If you study it in a few different people, one that always sticks out to me is Peter, right? Everybody loves Peter because he's got this awesome heart, right? And he just makes the most ridiculous mistakes at the same time. And one of the awesome things that he does is he is the first to identify Jesus as Christ, right? If you read through the Gospels, Mark is amazing because it's split perfectly, right? We're right in the middle of Mark. Peter identifies Jesus, and then the tone of the book kind of changes a little bit. Okay? In Matthew, he does the same. He says, Jesus is saying, who do people say that I am? And Peter comes out, you're the Christ, right? I'm like, yes, Peter, awesome. He says, blessed are you. Just several verses later, right? After he identifies him as the one and only Christ, what is Jesus telling him after he's so excited about him? Get behind me, Satan! How does that happen? This great blessing, and then 2 seconds later, get behind me, Satan. It's the opposite. Man, I see the same things in myself. And it's because God had a promise of what would happen for Jesus' life, and Peter wasn't ready to deal with that. Jesus is saying, I'm about to suffer and die for you. Peter's like, no way, dude. Don't even go there, right? What's God's will in your life that you're not really ready for? One more side note on this one that's really interesting to me, that kind of popped out to me just in my thinking of 7 and the lying about your wife. He didn't trust that God could do more. Abraham didn't trust that God could do more. In Ephesians, right, our ultimate example of Christ is in chapter 5, he's talking about husbands, love your wives as Christ did for the church, right? And he gave himself up for her. Here he fears to die for the sake of his wife. Those are opposites, right? David says in Psalms, the Lord is my helper, of whom shall I fear? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. That's the key. Is God with us? Funny thing is, yes, he's here, but do I want him here? All day, through everything. What do we worry about? I worry, I don't feel like I'm old, but the things that I worry about is, where have my 30s gone? All right, I'm getting closer to 40. Where have my 30s gone? It seems like just yesterday I was still able to like do normal things without having aches and pains all over my body. I just took, I get 2 weeks off, and I just took I'm a soccer coach, and I took what's called a national diploma. It's intense. It's a class that you have to take. It's from 8 in the morning till 8 at night. You have to teach other coaches that are, you know their stuff, and it's a little nerve-wracking, really intense, lots of instruction, lots of teaching, this last week was when I was going through that and wondering, like, where's my body going? I can't do this anymore, because the soccer, like, you can just play normally, and my body's not responding. So I played for 30 minutes, and I was done, right? Couldn't move anymore. But what is my legacy of my 30s, right? When I think of my students and my players, what are they going to remember about me? Are they going to remember the grace that I showed them? Or are they going to remember, like, the plays on the board? Right? Lots of times I think that what they're really going to remember is, like, the forward wide switch, right? The outside backs, this is your role. They're not going to remember that stuff. I can remember my relationship with them. My earliest experiences with baseball, I had a baseball coach that not only worked with me during practice, but took time out, his name was Gary, several times a week to just throw the ball with me, one-on-one. Throw the ball so I could hit it, catch it, run in the outfield. I'll never forget that stuff. I don't remember anything about what he actually taught me, like the physical skills, but I remember that he cared and that he was with me. That's what my kids are going to remember. I remember my college coach. I was in the middle of trying to decide, like, what does a Christian mean? Like, so I've become a Christian. I've been saved for a year now. And what does that look like? Am I any different than anybody else? He was instrumental in just kind of guiding me, just in conversation. I knew that I could talk to him. What do our relationships look like? Do we have those conversations with our kids, with our coworkers? Because all the work is good, but are you sharing Jesus? And then I definitely remember the bad examples as well. The ones that cussed me out after certain plays didn't work out perfectly. Right? That really felt good. In verse 8, the lie is totally snuffed out. When Isaac had been there a long time, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked down from a window and saw Isaac caressing his wife, Rebekah. Catches him in a moment of intimacy. And Abimelech summoned Isaac and said, "She's really your wife. Why'd you say she's my sister?" Have you ever been in a moment when a non-believer called you out as the believer? Man, that's hard. That's exactly what just happened here, right? It's embarrassing. Abimelech, the non-believer, calls out Isaac. Name in the Bible, right? Oh man, that's embarrassing. It's embarrassing because Jesus has called us to be salt and light. The light of the world. I remember that as an early believer, I got called out by a non-believer. Just going out late, drinking one night at parties, coming in the morning like I was all cool because I had just drunk. And she was like, "Is that what God wants you to do?" Man, that hurt. Yeah. So here we have a parallel again to the story of Abraham and the idea that sometimes fathers have such a influence on their sons that they go through the same stuff. Isaac answered him, "Because I thought I might lose my life on account of her." And then Abimelech said, "What is this you've done to us? One of the men might have slept with your wife and you would have brought guilt upon us." So Abimelech gave orders to all the people, "Anyone who molests this man or his wife shall surely be put to death." And Isaac planted crops in the land, and the same year reaped 100-fold because the Lord blessed him. The man became rich, and his wealth continued to grow, and he became very wealthy. He had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines envied him. So all the wells that his father's servants had dug in the time of his father Abraham, the Philistines stopped up, filling them with earth. What? Have you guys ever had to really dig? Right? One of my first jobs, my second job, was to be a laborer at a construction site at a house up in Sonora. And like, oh, cool, I'm working at a construction site. They're going to give me a hammer. I'll do like some cool stuff, putting some stuff together, and show up, shovel. Thought it was cool for a little bit, right? We had probably 100 yards of water line and electrical to go in the ground. And guess whose job it was to make the hole for that? Right? So the trencher works through part of it, but there's a lot of parts that ain't going to work because the rocks are too big, so you get your shovel. And I remember the blood, sweat, and blisters it took to make that hole. And if somebody had come up to me and stopped the well and put all the dirt right in, right, the war is on, right? It's not stopping. What does Isaac do here? Isaac, it's interesting because his character is different, right? He doesn't appear to be super angered at it. He's one of these personalities that just kind of goes with it and goes the other way. So they fill him up with earth. Then Abimelech said to Isaac, "Move away from us. You become too powerful for us." So Isaac moved away from there and encamped in the valley of Gerar and settled there. Super far away, right? Going from Gerar to the valley of Gerar, right? Working his way back. Isaac reopened the wells that had been dug in the time of his father Abraham, which the Philistines had stopped up after Abraham died. And he gave them the same name his father had given to them. Isaac's servants dug in the valley and discovered a fresh well of water there. But the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen and said, "The water is ours." So he named the well Essek because they had disputed with him. Then they dug another well, but they quarreled over that one also. So he named it Sitnah. He moved on from there and dug another well, and no one quarreled over it, and he named it Rehoboth, saying, "Now the Lord has given us room, and we will flourish in the land." So he keeps moving on and digging these wells, and they're discovering what? What are they discovering? Water, right? Put that in the context of the famine, and put that in the context of what water symbolizes in the Bible. Right? They discovered fresh water. Water is a sign of many things, right? Baptism, washing of the water with the word, the living water. Water is also a symbol of the Spirit, right? So in John chapter 7, verses 38 to 39, it speaks of the thirstiness and Jesus offering living water. And then in the next verse, it says that the water is the Spirit. So here they are finding these wells of water. And in my mind, I'm going, man, they're getting on fire, right? They're finding this water. It's the Spirit. And there's all this quarreling going on. Lost my verse. 23. From there he went up to Beersheba. And that night, the Lord appeared to him. Amazing. Right? They found the water, and the Lord appears again and said, "I'm the God of your father Abraham. Don't be afraid, because you're awesome. Because I'm with you. That's why. I'll bless you and will increase the number of your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham." Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord, and there he pitched his tents, and there his servants dug a well. So what's the message here? Maybe it's keep digging until there's room. That last well he named Rehoboth, meaning room, where the other two were fighting and quarrels and confrontation. Keep digging until there's room. Life comes with lots of disappointments. It's not always going to be the exact way we want it. We've got Jesus, but there's a lot of stuff along the way. Moments that have us wondering, is it time to move on? How long do I stay under this foothold of dispute, confrontation, annoyance, struggle? My work, is it of the Lord? And the answer of when to move on is, has the Lord opened the door? God has opened the door for Isaac. From here, he's going to go on to Beersheba, and he's just appeared to him a second time and told him, "I'm with you." Think of the same of all the others, how he's been with them, all the great leaders. They were not perfect. Abraham, Moses, Joshua, David, they all have supreme faults, but God was with them. My story began at the age of 17 in Sweden, in another country where I first fell on my knees and cried and gave it to God. It's where God first told me, "I'm with you, and I believe he'll never leave me again." That's where I first started to hand over my troubles to him. So here, Isaac, in this moment where God appears again to him, builds an altar. Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. And there he pitched his tent, and there his servants dug a well. Meanwhile, Abimelech had come to him from Gerar with Ahuzeth, his personal advisor, and Phicol, the commander of his forces. Isaac asked them, "Why have you come to me, since you were hostile to me and sent me away?" And they answered, "We saw clearly that the Lord was..." "That the Lord was..."
"With you."
Oh, man. So, I can feel it, and others can see it. That's a good spot to be. That's an amazing spot to be. That's where Isaac is right now. Do you smell of Jesus? Because that's what we're called to smell like, right? In the blood, sweat, and blisters, we're called to smell like Jesus. The Lord is with them. They answered, "We saw clearly that the Lord was with you, and we said, 'There ought to be a sworn agreement between us, between us and you. Let us make a treaty with you that you will do us no harm, just as we do not molest you, but always treated you well and sent you away in peace. Now you're blessed by the Lord.' Isaac made a feast for them, and they ate and drank. Early the next morning, the men swore an oath to each other. Then Isaac sent them on their way and left them in peace. That day, Isaac's servants came and told him about the well they had dug. They said, 'We found water!'" We just learned about water in the Spirit. They found it. "He called it Sheba, and to this day, the name of the town has been called Beersheba." In closing, what I want to remind us of this is this. In Hebrews 11, when it talks about the heroes of the faith, right, it goes through a long list of people. What's really bad is that it names everything that they did wrong in their life, right? No. When it talks about the story of Isaac, it talks about everything that he did right. Why? Because God has washed it away with the water. He remembers and recalls his victories. He talks about how Isaac blessed his children. God remembers your victory because Jesus has already paid the price. He remembers your victories, not your failures, so that we can press on. It's great news, because if you're here today in the same spot where you have Jesus, you've found water, living water, the same water as the woman at the well, right? "Whoever drinks this water I give him will never thirst. It will spring into eternal life." We're trees planted by the stream of water. The Bible is bookended with water at the end as well. When the story is over and the battle has been won, in Revelation, one of the last verses says, "Whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life." Wherever you are in your decisions, if you're in struggle, strife, if you're in between, God is with you still. Be blessed, because the road ahead is blessing if you know him. Amen? Amen? All right, would you bow your heads with me in prayer? So, Lord God, just thank you for this group of people, Lord God, and I just pray for them that they would know you and love you, Lord God, because you love them so much, Lord God. You have given everything for me. You've given everything for us here, Lord God. May we recognize that, Lord God. May we live in you. May we live by the Spirit. May we live washed by water, Lord God, continually dependent on you. You are with us, Lord God. Thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.